Frosty the Snowman was a jolly happy soul, with a corn cob pipe and a button nose and two eyes made out of coal. Frosty the Snowman is a fairy tale they say. He was made of snow, but the children know that he came to life in the world.
Thank you so much
for all the many blessings on this family,
for this bountiful harvest of Domino's, KFC, and the always delicious Taco Bell.
And we ask that you look after us on this holiday season, that we may never forget how very fortunate we are. Amen.
Thanks, Mr. Narwhal.
You know, I'm really thankful for Jesus.
I'm thankful for Sean.
I'm thankful for Anna.
I'm thankful that Thanksgiving is better than Christmas. Ah!
We're doing both.
Oh! Happy Thanksgiving, little fellas.
We wish you a happy Christmas.
We wish you a
Merry Christmas.
We wish you a
Merry Chrysler.
Happy.
It's Christmas.
For those who are watching via live stream or a podcast later on, or and you don't know what's going on, we don't either. Love the video. Thank you for those who put that together. I hope it made you laugh. And only Kentucky Wesleyan College can do Thanksgiving, Christmas, a gospel choir, and all those things, communion, all in the same 30 minutes. And so we don't want to waste any time. Thank you for being here. If you're here for the first time and visiting with us, welcome. And welcome back to all you veterans of chapel. I just talked with Logan down here just a second ago. I can't believe that this is the last chapel. and of 2020. In so many ways, we want 2020 to be gone, but also in so many ways, it's tough. It's tough for us to leave each other. We all need a break desperately, and we need God to renew us, but we have so much to be thankful for. And we want to celebrate our community, our faith family together. We want to celebrate Jesus today. And one of the things that I want to do is thank you to the service interns who made our Thanksgiving and Christmas decorations possible. Give them a round of applause if you don't mind. They looked really good. They looked really good. Also, as soon as I finish up here, we're going to have a gospel choir that's going to come up and lead us. I want to thank them in advance for leading us in music today and worship in that way. And then I have an opportunity for you. If I know some people have already left. Some people are leaving this afternoon. Some people are leaving tomorrow and so on. But we have an opportunity the rest of the day, today and tomorrow and part of Friday, to be able to help two children in the Owensboro Davis County community. And I need two teams of three. If you're going to be around and you're willing to take some resources that God has given us in order to be on two different teams for two young little girls, they if you'll just see Anna or me after the service is over, then you can be on Team Shayla or Team Nevaeh and go shopping for them. I would love to talk to you about it if you're interested in doing that. Just see us after the service. We have an opportunity to be a blessing to those two little girls during Christmas time. So if you would, just see us after chapel. Also, I'm going to do, I am doing a welcome, but I'm going to do an opening prayer as the gospel choir comes. And I just want to thank you all so much for being here during this special time. So before I pray, I would love for you to think about your family and your Panther family as we pray. Pray with me. Father, thank you so much for this day that you have blessed us with. God, I want to thank you for the ability to wake up this morning, for the very breath of life, God, that we have. God, I want to thank you for the gifts and the talents that are represented here in this room, in this space. God, thank you for a place to be able to come and gather together in worship. God, thank you for a campus community that is supportive of us coming together and worshiping together. God, for students and faculty and staff that are willing to share their faith and to come together today for us to be able to thank you and to celebrate you and to praise you for two of the most wonderful times of the year, a time for Thanksgiving, a time for family, a time for friends, and also a time to celebrate the greatest gift ever given in Jesus. God, thank you for this time. Bless each speaker, each person that will share in any way. Holy Spirit, come. Make this place holy ground. May only the things of your Holy Spirit prosper in our lives and in this time together. God, forgive us and help us when we make it about us and we're not very grateful. God, and we forget about why we're even here or the reason for our seasons. God, just help us, forgive us, walk with us. All these things we pray in the strong and powerful name of Jesus, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. And I waited on two claps and a flare so that I could have some strength here behind me. So what I'd like for you to do is take your hands, and before we stand together, I want you to two claps and a flare with me on my cue. And for those who don't know what's going on, we're doing something really cool, and just do the best that you can to follow along. Two claps and a flare. Sorry,
I'm the storage intern, and tonight we're having our last storage of the semester. We're having Dr. Powell Beeson speak and Matthew Morris, a worship intern. Alright, so be there or be square.
Oh, yeah. Thank you.
Hey, let's give the Lord and our family a round of applause for that. I want to thank them so much for sharing their gifts and talents. They worked really, really hard, and they were a blessing to me, and I know they're a blessing to you. Dr. Coleman and I are going to share a couple of things with you that God's put on our hearts, and then we're going to go right into our communion service time, Thanksgiving and Christmas communion with you all before we leave campus. And so one of the things that I love to do is to thank God. I find myself many times, sometimes almost feeling guilty for the blessings that God has given me and my family. There was a time in my life where I wasn't as grateful as I needed to be, and I have learned through God growing in me how thankful I need to be, because I remember where I was and the need that I had for a Savior and the need that I had in so many aspects of my life, and Jesus stepped in and made all of my dreams and all of my hopes happen. And I'm very thankful for that. One of the things that I want to make sure that we do is, if you have your chapel handout, you can follow along with us. But in this short period of time, there's a lot of people that come in, and I get the privilege of being able to talk with, and they talk about, I just want to know the will of God for my life. In so many different areas, they want to know the will of God for my life overall, and then in these specific areas. And listen, the answer to that question in any area is found in God's Word. And throughout God's Word, He tells us God's will for each of our lives. And I just want you to know that during this Thanksgiving time, and maybe this Thanksgiving more than any other time in your life, specifically in my life, because of where we are in society, because of what we're dealing with, you know, globally with this pandemic, but also where we are in history as far as the need for God in the lives of those around us, within our government, within our businesses, within our homes, within our schools, all of those things. Man, do we ever need revival, and man, do we ever need Jesus to show up in a powerful way. And Jesus is showing up anywhere and everywhere that we allow Him to. And we make the opportunity for Him to come in and step in. We have so much to be thankful for. And I just touched on a few things in here. Paul to the Thessalonian believers was exhorting them in many different areas on how it should be that Christians should be acting and living. And one of those things is what we talk about around Thanksgiving time, and that's how grateful we should be. And no matter the circumstances, we can find reasons to be grateful. Paul says that it's the will of God for our lives that in everything we should give thanks. So whatever the circumstances, whatever the situation you're in, good, bad, ugly, hopeless, or whatever it is, we should give thanks because that is the will of God for our lives. And there are many things that should mark the life of a Christian, of a believer in Jesus Christ. And we know the fruits of the Spirit that should be evident in our lives. And we should be constantly praying and talking to God, but we should also constantly be thankful. Because regardless of what we're dealing with, we can be thankful in all of our circumstances. I just think about these, for instance. Thankful for God's grace, because God's grace is more than able to sustain us in all circumstances. I'm thankful, and are you thankful, that nothing can separate us from the love of God? Are we thankful because in Christ, He's working everything out for our good? And most of all, isn't it amazing that it's the will of God for us to be thankful, not for some things, but in all things? And let me share a little bit about what late 2019 and all of 2020 have been like. And I thought about this, and God said, just share. I have two children, and they are both driving age. And over the last calendar year, my son was in a three-car accident that totaled one of our vehicles. I wasn't thankful for that accident, but in the middle of it, I had so much to be thankful for because three cars totaled and no one was hurt. And my son was able to call me and say, this is what's happened. I wasn't thankful for the accident, but I had so much to be thankful for in that accident. And then in March, somebody ran over the top of my daughter's car and totaled it. She and her roommate, not hurt, wasn't thankful for the accident. But in the middle of that, I was thankful that she was okay and her roommate was okay and that no one was hurt. And then just a few months ago, she was hit again in a parking lot and messed up another vehicle. I'm not thankful for all the insurance things that I had to do. I'm not thankful for the money that we were out. I'm not thankful for those things happening. What I am thankful for is that God took care of our kids. We have so much to be thankful for. I grew up without medical insurance and a lot of things. We had insurance that helped us with all those things. And something to be thankful for. Many times we find ourselves in situations with masks on and separated out and having to do this and having to do that. We're not thankful for those things. But let me tell you, you can be thankful in those things. There's a difference. And I just hope and pray that during this season we can count our blessings, because it's the will of God for us to be thankful in all things. Dr. Coleman.
Right. From Thanksgiving to Christmas. Not that there's not a relationship there between those two. Hey, everybody. Some of you have encountered the five love languages. You've either read that book or you know the ideas. I won't mention all of them, but one of those ways that some people feel especially loved, in other words, they feel loved by a lot of things, but they always feel loved in this way, is one of those languages is receiving gifts. My wife's love language is receiving gifts. Now, don't think this is a materialistic thing. It's not. Usually that has nothing to do with the gift, how expensive it is, or where it came from, or it's not a materialistic, selfish sort of orientation. But just that you sense someone else is being loving toward you when you receive a gift. Well, I kind of think of a few years ago, I know this is my wife's love language. You know, I want to love my wife more. So that means more gifts, right? So Christmas came around, and I got her a pair of running shoes that year for Christmas. And of course, we had to do a little preview. It wasn't a total surprise. We had to do, you know, some arrangement there, her size and color and all that. But I decided when I started wrapping, hey, two gifts are better than one. So I wrapped the left shoe in the shoe box that came in, just kept it in there, wrapped that up, and then I found a larger box for the right shoe. And so I put the right shoe in there, wrapped it up. This is going to be, I'm looking in the mirror saying, genius. So we get to Christmas morning, and we're at her parents' home that year, and she opens some other stuff. Then she opens the large box. The large box. And you know, large box kind of signals maybe large present, but not this time. So she opens it up, and there is her shoe. One shoe. And I'm thinking, wow. We're halfway there. Halfway there. And she opens it up. I can tell the way she looked at the shoe. She's not on the same page where I've been going with this. So she looks at the shoe, and she looks at me, and we go on. She opens other presents. Then she gets to what looks like a shoe box, where you get to the shoe box. So she opens it up, and there is the other shoe. And I'm still hoping against hope, even by the look she's giving, that this was more love. This was more love. She didn't do math the way I did. Here's the way this turns out. when you open a present and a full present isn't in it, it's not even half a present. It is a very incomplete present. When you open the other, and even though the other half is in it, it's not a complete present. So I went from thinking two presents, genius in the mirror, to now not even equaling one present. Because they weren't both together, because they weren't packaged. So her love language, I have had to try to learn her love language, and that is not one way of increasing. Just in case you're wondering, do the math differently, that is not a way of increasing the love. So, we often, and we should often, think of Christmas as a gift. There is a reason that we give those. And you know how it works. So, first of all, there's choosing to give. You can't give everyone you know a Christmas present, probably. So you choose who are the people in your life that this is going to be an expression at Christmas time, you're getting them a gift. It says something about your relationship with them, whether it's a friendship or a workplace relationship, or whether it's your family, or whether it's spouse. It says something about you've chosen to give a gift or gifts to this person. First step. Choosing to give. And then you know there is the presentation. There's the wrapper. Now what I've learned with Tammy is that it's not just the gift, but that the wrapping is a part of the gift.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Hey, after years and years, I start to get it. So, the wrapping says, I've taken time. I've thought of you. It's your birthday. I don't have Christmas wrapping on your birthday present. So the wrapping is actually already kind of a taste of the gift itself. Then we have the giving of the gift, you know, and the gift itself is important. If you open the box, there's nothing there. Obviously, something's gone wrong with the gift giving. And then there's the receiving of the gift. There is, really, when you watch someone open a gift and it's meaningful to them, that's your gift. That's that moment where you say, we're sort of sharing in this gift. Giving is one way. I am blessed, or this is meaningful to be able to give. Well, one of the most well-known verses in all the Bible, John 3:16, really gives some insight into the gift-giving that God has made possible for Christmas. For God so loved the world that he gave. There it is. God so loved the world that he gave. So God chooses, step one, to give. And in fact, that small word, so, lets us in on the degree of the love of God that he gives, that he wants to give. Love almost always demands a response of giving. There's just that in love that wants to do that. So God so loved the whole world, that he gave. What did he give? He gives his only son. Now, not just one thing on the shelf, there's many of them on the shelf at Walmart, but a unique gift. He gives his only son. And how does that happen? How is the gift? First, how is the gift really received? In the flesh. Jesus is human. This is what so many of us have missed during our COVID experience, is the humanness, the connection, the handshake, the hug, the closeness, the seeing someone's eyes, watching over their feet, all those nonverbals. Haven't you missed that? It's this human, it's this humanity that we share together. And in fact, the fact that COVID is all around the world says that we're all human. I mean, that someone else around the world can get sick, just like me. We're all human. But in this sense, John 3:16 says this humanity that Jesus takes on as a gift is very important. In the first 3 centuries of the church, the most guarded, the most defended doctrine is the incarnation. Because the early church knew if Christmas is not true, if the incarnation of Jesus coming in the flesh, if that's not true, it all starts to unravel. The fact that Jesus heals people. He heals them in his flesh and he heals them in their body. The fact that Jesus teaches face to face doesn't drop out of heaven. The fact of the crucifixion, that Jesus dies in a body, and that body is resurrected, not just kind of a hopeful story. That body that was there is now alive. All of that is the incarnation. And when we lose that, it's the jenga at the bottom. You pull it out, it all goes down. So the church defended the doctrine of the incarnation. That's that giving of the gift in human flesh. And like I just said, God gives Jesus, God so loved the world he gave his only son, and Jesus gives himself. That's Good Friday. Jesus gives himself.
Yeah.
And then, of course, we have this package. Jesus is in this package, and the gift has to be received. And I love the way John puts that in the first chapter of his gospel, where he says, you know, there are those who did not believe. And he said, but to those who received, that's gift language.
Yes.
But to those who received, give the power to become the children of God. So there you have it, wrapped up almost all of it there in John 3:16. And that's why it is so meaningful of a verse to us. The gift of Jesus. And this is reflected, supposed to be reflected, in every gift I give this season. Amen? Alright. Are we ready to commune together? Okay. In your seat when you came, a small cup that has both elements in it for our communion today. I don't know if you have, don't quite open that yet, not quite, but I don't know if you have done that. I'll give instructions around that here in a moment if you've never had to open that before. But I wonder if just in just a quiet, prayerful moment, if you would bow, when you're in silence, confess your sins to God. Hear the good news. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Amen. On the night that Jesus gave himself up for us, he took bread and he gave thanks to you, Father. He broke the bread and he gave it to his disciples and said, take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. To do this in remembrance. When the supper was over, Jesus took the cup and he gave thanks to you and he gave it to his disciples and he said, drink of this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for the forgiveness, for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. And if you would take your cup, and there are two peel back tops on this. If you kind of carefully peel back the first, a moment here, kind of get the right one.
I think Anna set you up.
Yeah.
She's like that. She's like that.
wants for her to look better than everyone else. You know what? We're just going to pick another one. That's just, there, look at this. Unbelievable. It's like they made it to work otherwise. There you go.
And now if you would take your wafer, this is the body of Christ broken. And then some people like to point that next top away from them. Well, it doesn't matter really, but pull back the top. This is the blood of Christ shed for you.
You would pray with me. Father, thank you for this day that you have blessed us with. God, we thank you that you loved us so much that you gave the most unbelievable, unimaginable gift possible for each of us. God, I pray for those here who have received that. I pray for those who have yet to receive Jesus into their heart and life as Savior and Lord. God, I pray for those who are struggling now. I pray for those who are maybe without a little hope. God, I pray for those who are in circumstances where they find it hard to be grateful. God, I pray that you be with each one who is here, their families. I pray for those who are listening and those families. I pray for those who are watching and their families. God, I pray that during this Thanksgiving and Christmas season, God, that our lives as believers can be marked by prayer and can be marked by thankfulness. God, help us to be people of gratitude. And God, thank you so much for your sacrifice, for the incarnation, for Jesus. God, walk with these, talk to these, keep them safe during the break. And God, I pray that they can unplug and rest, but they'll make the effort to plug into you even more than they ever have before. God, bless their break. God, keep them healthy. And God, bring us back together. All of these things we pray in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Happy Thanksgiving and Merry Christmas. You all have a great rest of the week.